Christ Church Online, we are so glad that you have made the decision to join us today. We've got an awesome service planned for you, but we're now going into worship if you'd like to sing along.
Our Father, high above, hallowed be your name. Reveal to us again who you are. All things are possible, God of the miracle. Oh, let your will be done. We pray for heaven today. Your kingdom to reign always, here on earth as in heaven. Here on earth as in heaven. You give us all we need, forgive us everything. Help us to love as you have loved us. Now come and build your throne as we go where you go. God, our deliverer, we pray for heaven here today.
Today, your kingdom to reign.
When I've just gone through the motions, I'm sorry. When I just sang another song, take me back to where we started. I open up my heart to you. I'm sorry when I've come with my agenda. I'm sorry when I forgot that you're enough. Take me back to where we started. I open up my heart to you. I'm caught up in your presence. I just want to sit here at your feet. I'm caught up in this holy moment. I never want to leave. Oh, I'm not here for blessings. And Jesus, you don't owe me anything more than anything that you can do. I just want you. And I'm sorry when I've just gone through the motions. I'm sorry when I just sang another song. Take me back to where we started. I open up my heart to you. And I'm sorry when I've come with my agenda. I'm sorry when I forgot you're enough. Take me back to where we started. I open up my heart to you. Nothing else will do. I just want you. And nothing else. And nothing else. Nothing else will do. I just want you. And nothing else. And nothing else. Nothing else will do. Oh, I just want you. And nothing else. And nothing else. Nothing else will do. I just want you. And nothing else. And nothing else. Nothing else will do. I just want you, and nothing else, and nothing else, nothing else will do. Thank you.
What a great time we've just had in worship, singing about the King of Kings, singing to the King of Kings, the God of the possible. In Matthew 19:26, Jesus is talking to his disciples and he says this: humanly speaking, it is impossible, but with God, everything is possible. That means everything. God is the God of the possible. I don't know what your impossible is today. I don't know what it looks like. It could be that you're sick. It could be that you are waiting for a loved one to return home, to get a phone call, to get connected with you again. I don't know what it is, but I want you to bring it to God. You know, recently I had an answer to prayer, and it was a prayer that I was asking for 30 years. And do you know what? A phone call came through. Actually, it was a text message. And it was a contact from somebody that I've been waiting for, a reconnection. You see, God is the God of the possible. I want to challenge you today, be persistent in your prayers because God will come through.
Thank you, Helen, for that great encouragement. We've got loads of awesome stuff happening here at Arena. Every Tuesday and Thursday at 7 a.m. we have our upper Zoom, and this is our early morning prayer. We would love to see you on that. On the 15th of July at 7 p.m. we have our Bible school, and this is going to be led by our teaching pastor, Phil. It's a great night together, and we'd encourage you to get onto that. We loved having our kids back in our in-person services this week, and for when they're running, you can find that on the website, and all the information will be on there to how you can get them booked in. On the website, there's a Connect card. If you're new and you've recently found us, that's a great place to get connected to Arena. It'll help you get plugged in to what's happening in the life of the church. There's also a prayer request section. If you've got a need, one of our team here would love to be praying for you and stand with you in that situation. But there's also a praise report bit. We want to hear about the great stuff God has done in your life, so fill that out too. There's loads of ways that you can give, and they're all found on the website. And we want to say thank you, church, for being so, so generous. And all the ways that you can give will be found on the Church Online page. We are now going into our message, and we're going to...
Hey everyone, it's great to be with you today. I'm really thrilled to have the opportunity to share God's word with you. And if it's your first time with us today, we give you a very warm welcome. My name's Kristian Thorpe. I'm the lead pastor of Arena Church. And we're one church in 7 locations, including the online. And of course, many of our services in our locations are now, locations are opening up. And we'd encourage you, if you're nearby one of our locations, why don't you pop in and see us on a Sunday? I'm aware there are still people who are staying online, and we are thrilled that you are here together, because the most important thing is that we gather at times like this. It's great for me to open up God's Word, and we're in a series called All Joy. And it's an appropriate series because obviously there's been a lack of joy. And we're taking it from the book of Philippians. And Philippians was written by Paul, and it's a book in the New Testament. And there's just 4 chapters. And the common theme that runs through this very encouraging book is joy. Let me take you to a verse in Philippians in chapter 4 and verse 4. It reads, "Rejoice in the Lord always. Again, I will say, rejoice." Now, last week we heard how we can have joy in adverse circumstances. Why is that possible? And how is that possible? Well, I honestly believe that joy's foundation is not based on happenings or upon just happiness. Neither is it around goodwill or the benevolence of others, and those things are nice. And joy is certainly not found in the pleasures or material gains, nor the opportunities that present themselves to us, nor even adventures. I honestly believe that joy, its foundation and its base and the anchor is found in Jesus. If it's your first time here today, you're going to hear much about Jesus. And at the end of our time that I have with you, I'd like to encourage you with a prayer for you to invite this Jesus, this person Jesus, into your life. You see, Paul knew this joy. He knew this always joy. When he says rejoice in the Lord always, he's saying joy in the Lord always. I will say again, joy. And he knew how hard, Paul knew how hard this always joy would often be. You know, he wrote these words from prison. In Philippians 1 verse 13, we notice that he was in prison. And yet even in the loneliness and the uncertainty of being in captivity, he found real joy, real joy. You see, Paul could say, always be joyful because he had suffered so much, and yet he had rejoiced even in those dark, lonely, and painful places. Many people have found themselves and do find themselves in very dark, lonely, painful places. In fact, as I was coming here today, I had an interaction with a man who knows, he may even be on the broadcast today, and I just felt prompted to go and talk to him, and just realized his story. He just said, I'm in a dark place. The pain of it all is too much for me. And thank God that we've got a community ministry that reaches out to people and helps people who feel like they've blown it. And thankfully, was able to just take him to a group of team who would help him and support him at this particular time. Because the pain is so great, and yet Paul is able to say, keep rejoicing. I read this recently, never settle for a God who cannot satisfy you in a prison cell. If you only enjoy God when life seems good, follow Paul's joy to something more precious than gold, even much more than fine gold, something sweeter than honey and anything else that you might enjoy. Joy in adverse circumstances, it's possible. But Paul then shifts gear in Philippians in chapter 2, because in there he addresses this thought of joy in humility. And that's what we're going to look at today. We're going to look at how Paul talks about the life of Jesus. And we're going to plot this whole journey of Jesus' walk and this humble walk. And we're going to see how it's possible to have joy in the midst of humility. In Philippians in chapter 2, verse 2, just turn to it if you will for a moment. And as always, if you've not got a Bible, please contact us and we'll make sure that we get one sent to you. He says this, make my joy complete by being like-minded. He was talking about the like-mindedness of Jesus, which was the example of humility. And he says, and if you do so, you will make my joy complete. You see, there is joy in humility. This virtue of joy, let's take a moment. Come on, just have a moment with me. This virtue of humility is not really promoted. It's not publicized. It doesn't stand head and shoulders above others, and yet it should. And why is that? Because we have a culture, which I'll come on to, of the exact opposite. And Paul writes to the Philippians about the humility of Jesus and how you can find joy in it. And he writes, again, into a context that did not esteem the value and virtue of humility. You see, the first century was very much like the 21st century. It was all about self-exaltation, getting the best places, and they did not place a high value on humility. This virtue of humility, the opposite to it, this is what it says. And I've said these things to you before. Let me just really nail it down for those who can really understand it. People who say, be the number one. Or you're seeking to be at the top of the table. We're told, make yourself glamorous, gorgeous, attractive for everybody. Get ahead and use force if necessary. Position, power and prestige, they're yours for the taking. And feast your eyes on all the pleasures of this world that can offer you. Go and seize them. These are statements that are put out through all different kind of mediums. And we've bought the lie. And it's a virtue, not a positive one. It's a value, not a positive one. Because it's about pride. Now, you may say, well, that's a bit over the top. I'm not into those things. I've lived different to that. And I understand. I would say most people don't live out of those kinds of things because they're extreme. But I would honestly say, as I've searched my heart, as I've wrote this message, that many of us have drunk the poison of pride. It's subtle and sweet and seductive. It's intoxicating, but it leads us to death. It's pride has an attitude, it has an aura, it has a fragrance. You know when you're around pride. It has a stance, it has a presence. It's not good. And it, pride, says, here's some other thoughts, I'll do it my way, I'm in control, I'm always right, it's your fault, it's never mine. I have no need of others. I live as an island. I have no need of God. Now, many of us have said these things. And what a sad place it is, because this too is a place called pride. Jesus addressed the crowd and he said, what is it if you gain the whole world and yet you'll forfeit your own soul? And many, many people are gaining, driving, climbing, pursuing, pushing. It's driven out of pride, and they'll gain what they gain, and yet they lose their own souls. Pride. It's a massive challenge to each and every one of us. And Jesus taught and modeled a different kind of life. You know, for me, one of the greatest messages of all time, and I love Winston Churchill's speeches, I love hearing Martin Luther King's speeches. There are some powerful speeches that have gone on over time, and I enjoy messages. I love TED Talks, I love listening to different kinds of messages and different kinds of mediums. But for me, the greatest message of all is the one that Jesus taught on the Sermon on the Mount. It's found in Matthew in chapter 5 and 6 and 7. And in there, Jesus addresses and teaches and searches the hearts of men and women, because he addresses the behavior of man. Let's read for a moment from Matthew chapter 5 and verse 3 as he begins this great message, because he says, then he began his teaching by saying this, how happy, how joyful are the humble minded, for the kingdom of God is theirs. Let's read that for a moment. How happy, how joyful are the humble minded, for the kingdom of heaven is theirs. Wow, what a statement. Jesus is saying you can find joy in humility. Joyful people, they are content, they are complete, they are blessed, they are confident. Those who live with humility. And we don't find it because we don't go looking for it. And we've never heard messages that really encourage us to go and pursue this life of humility. We must deculturalize ourselves. I don't know whether that's a phrase, but you'll tell me. We need to detox. I've heard people say I'm on a liquid fast and all that, and they're just detoxing the body. I get it. But we need to detox ourselves. We need to deculturalize ourselves from some of the prideful attitudes and virtues that we see in the world and we've bought and we live with. We need to be free from them. Because Jesus here is saying it's important that we live with humble minds. Not looking always for an advantage, to get ahead, to sit in the best places. In fact, we do what Jesus do. We do the exact opposite. Now, let me give you a real, I need to help some people here, because it may be your first time, like I've said, and you're thinking, well, what is humility? Just give me, in a few words, a few sentences, what humility is. And Phil Pye, our teaching pastor, brought a great thought around humility just a few weeks ago in a leadership context. And he took it from a book called Humilitas, A Lost Key to Life, Love and Leadership by John Dixon. And in it, John writes, humility, and I love this quote, that's why I'm using it. Humility is the noble choice to forgo your status and to deploy your resources or use your influence for the good of others before yourself. That is a great statement and definition of humility. It's to forgo, it's to lay down and go second for the sake of others. That is what I'm talking about. And we don't see that around. And I'm challenged. How easy do I let somebody out of the traffic who was trying to turn in and I'm coming down? Because I want to get ahead. I can see the traffic before me and they're waiting patiently. And yet, if nobody does it to me, I'm muttering and chuntering in the car, those silly people that don't need to learn how to drive. And yet I do exactly the same thing. Now you may say that's a bit extreme. I'm not sure it is. I think this is where we've got to let it go deeper. Are we happy for somebody to just cut in on us? I mean, what does it really matter? If it takes a few moments, a few minutes to alleviate the blood pressure. I know people have jumped in on me. I've tapped them on the shoulder. Excuse me, mate, we are waiting. You say, really, have you done that, Christian? Oh, yeah, I've done it. And yet, really, what it does, it creates blood pressure moments. We don't need it. Let's live with humility. Let's not just talk about it, because the second thing is, let's show it. Let's live with it. And Jesus showed it. And this is where Paul picks up, and I want to take us to Philippians and chapter 2. Because Paul uses the life of Jesus when thinking about joy and humility. And he shows how Jesus lived his life. So come with me. Let's read together these verses from Philippians and chapter 2. And I'm going to begin from verse 2. And I'm actually going to read it from the Passion Translation. And don't worry, because it will come on the screen. This is what he says. So I'm asking you, my friends. This is Paul writing to the church in chains. So I'm asking you, my friends, that you be joined together in perfect unity with one heart and passion and united in one love. Walk together with one harmonious purpose, and you will fill my heart with unbounded joy. Be free from pride-filled opinions, for they will only harm your cherished unity. Don't allow self-promotion to hide in your hearts, but in authentic humility, put others first and view others as more important than yourselves. Verse 4, and abandon every display of selfishness. Possess a greater concern for what matters to others instead of your own interests. And consider the example that Jesus gave to us, the anointed one, that he has set before us. Let his mindset become your motivation. These words are incredibly powerful. And I want to just take us on a journey for a few moments, as I said, to help us how we can obtain joy and humility. Because it's something we need to pursue. And Paul really takes us on a journey of Jesus' life, and he shows us how it's possible. So firstly, I want us to consider, number one, we need to be joined in unity. We need to be joined in unity. These things all take us to humility. We won't get a humility if we don't do these things. We need to be joined in unity. He says, walk harmoniously in purpose and on purpose. There's a purpose to our walking, and we want to be joined in unity. And this is, of course, is addressing a group of Christians, and I'm in essence addressing a group of Christians. You may not be, but I want to encourage you to become part of the family of God, become part of, you know, God, because he wants you to be united with him, and he wants us to be united one with another. And this unity means that we will have to deal with issues, but we want to do it lovingly and graciously and compassionately. We want to defer and prefer. We hold this value of unity. It's like a precious oil. There's been many people across Arena Church who may have been involved in other churches before, and they've realized there's a disunity. They may have been the cause of the disunity. I want to encourage us to live with unity, to do everything we can to live at peace one with another. I'm not talking about being a doormat. I'm not talking about speaking out. I'm not talking about confronting and challenging things. They're all in the Bible and they're all important. But we do everything we can to walk harmoniously one with another. How about in the home? How about husbands and wives, wives and husbands, with children? Kids in your school places, with your friends. Don't keep falling out, petty arguments. There needs to be an ease to life and relationship. And this unity is a choice. Secondly, he also says, we with one heart, one passion, and united in one love. So secondly, live with love towards God and others. We won't find humility if we don't live with love. And we've got to love from our hearts. And sometimes, yes, it is a matter of choice. But we love with everything, with all our being. We love God with everything. And we love the person at the side of us with everything. And if you're struggling in this area, ask God to help you with this love. Because this love will mark us. And this love will mark your life. This love is a weapon. It's a weapon of our warfare as Christians. As we show our love to one another and to our world, it becomes a marker. It becomes a weapon of warfare to darkness. Nobody can overcome love. Love never fails. Love always overcomes. This is the greatest marketing campaign of all. We were talking about how we can market in Ilkeston, one of our projects that we wanted to, it's now, out, we're out of lockdown, it's called The Project. It has a great coffee shop, it has a great furniture and clothing area, and you need to come and visit it. And we're saying, how can we market it? Because all the profits that we hope to make, we're not making anything at the minute, we're losing, but we hope to make, are poured back into the community across all the locations. Beautiful vision and thought, it really is. And we'll talk about a campaign, a marketing campaign. And we'll, of course, run with that and we'll go at it. But some people are trying to do marketing campaigns where the greatest marketing campaign of all is you love your fellow neighbor. You love God with all your heart. And people will know. Jesus said, by this, everyone will know that you are my disciples through love. I love the fact that love is expressed as well. Can I give a big shout out to one of our campuses? It's very special and precious to my heart because it's down at the Hub in our community facility. It runs on Mondays at 10:30. Sorry, it's 11 o'clock. Let me get it right. 11 o'clock. We have all an eclectic mix of people here and they listen to this on the Monday. So they're listening to it now. And I say this because there are numbers of people who have come from difficult backgrounds. They weren't raised like many of us. They didn't get a great start in life. Numbers of people have been in prison. Numbers of people who were there have lived with shame. They felt discarded and they felt pushed aside, disenfranchised. Many of them came broken. But I love these guys. And I love it that in Luke 7 verse 47, Jesus in essence says this, those who have sinned much, love much. And these guys, I'm not saying they're worse than me because they're not. Sin is sin. But they know and understand their shame. But what's beautiful about being with them, they won't talk it mushy love. A lot of these are hardened guys. But they love and they sense love and they know love. And they're changing. And God is doing a good work. I said to one of them only last week, you're changing. And the very essence of this campus and all of our campus is love. Love is in the air. No, we'll leave it, shall we? Love needs to be at the very part and essence of what we do. Number three, if we're going to find this humility, we need to be free from pride-filled opinions. Come on, let's go back to Philippians in chapter 2. Because he says this, be free from pride-filled opinions. Can I encourage you in this moment, be free. Some of you, as I was coming here, around these two words that were ringing in my mind, some of you need to be free from habits. And in this moment, you're being set free. Be free from habits. Be free from fear. Be free from anxiety in Jesus' name. As I look in the camera. And Paul says, be free from pride-filled opinions. We have to untangle the mess. The conceited. My mum would say it a little bit nicer, full of ourselves. I would probably say they're so far up themselves. I know that's not a nice phrase, but you get the picture. And oftentimes we can look at others like that, but we can be like that too. And we have to be free from these pride-filled opinions. Proverbs 16 verse 2 says this, we are in love with our own opinions, convinced they're right. I don't know whether you know anybody like that. We need to be free from that. We need to have a reality check. We're not always right. And if we don't get free from these things, Paul goes on to say, they will harm your unity, your togetherness. And our unity gives us the ability to win together. And we won't win if we don't get free of these things. Number four, we need to live with authentic, humble simplicity. Live with authentic, humble simplicity. Let me take you back to Philippians in chapter 2 again, because he says there, but in authentic humility, put others first and view others as more important than yourselves. I love the life of Billy Graham. Billy Graham was an evangelist. He's now in eternity. And he said he preached to more people in the modern day than anybody else. He walked with presidents. He walked with high-powered business people. And he also walked with the lowly. And yet he remained absolutely untouched. And somebody wrote a book about him called The Leadership Secrets of Billy Graham. It's worthy of a read. And in one of the chapters, he talks about how Billy Graham redeemed his ego. You see, the writer says that Billy Graham lived with purpose and ambition, but he also stayed very close to humility. It got me thinking in the context of what does this look like for us. So let me give you a thought around this. Living with authentic, humble simplicity and redeeming our ego. Listen to me. A redeemed ego is someone who lives and leads with conviction, with drive and purpose. That's what Arena Church wants to do. We want to live with purpose, on purpose, with vision, with conviction, whilst equally walking in the knowledge of where we have come from. Never forgetting our roots and our pasts. And knowing who deserves all the glory. Listen, we need to have this drive and ambition to go into the world, to make a difference, to make a mark, to build, to progress. I'm all for that. But we never lose where we've come from. We never forget where we started. We see ourselves, not there, but we see ourselves here. And we recognize that when God does anything good in our lives, it's all from Him. And we give all glory to Him. This is what it means to live with authentic, humble simplicity. And lastly, we've got to put away ambition and vanity. Because Paul says, consider others first. Verse 4, abandon every display of selfishness. Possess a greater concern for what matters to others instead of our own interests. Jesus modeled, exemplified this life of humility as he washed his disciples' feet, as he served the lowly. God coming to earth, born into dirt, to serve the sins of mankind. Verse 2 and 3 of Philippians 2 says this, don't push your way to the front, don't sweet talk your way to the top. Put yourself aside and help others get ahead. Don't be obsessed with getting for your own advantage. Forget yourselves long enough to lend a helping hand. We need to put away ambition and vanity. And then Paul says this, let his mindset, Jesus, his mindset become your motivation. You see, the most influential and inspiring people are always marked by humility. C.S. Lewis, the great writer of the 20th century, said this, humility is not thinking less of yourself, but it's thinking of yourself less. Paul was leading us all to this point when he addressed humility because he wants us to experience the joy-filled life of humility. What a virtue to pursue and gain. And in these closing moments, I was left as I wrote this, and I hope you've been blessed by it and been challenged by it to put away those things. But I also want to leave a practical takeaway because it's important. I know I've been around church long enough and heard a lot of message. They tell you what you should do, but they don't help you how to. And I really wrote, I saw this and I added some things to it of how we can cultivate, deepen, develop humility in our lives. So this is the how to. Let me just give you 7 quick things. I'm just going to race through them and then we're going to pray a prayer. But if this is you saying, oh, I need some help in this area, well then lean in and listen because these will help you. Number one, if you want to develop and deepen and cultivate humility, number one, you've got to admit your weaknesses. You've got to admit your weaknesses. Secondly, you've got to be patient with others and their weaknesses. That's a big challenge to me. I want everybody to be patient with me, but I don't want to be patient with others. And this is how we experience the joy of humility. Number three, we have to be open to correction. In fact, we have to invite it. Who are you inviting into your world to bring correction to your life? Because if you say, I don't need any correction in my life, then you are a proudful man or woman. Because we all need people who will speak into our lives, who can help us to get better. Number four, point the spotlight on others. If you want to develop and deepen and cultivate this life of humility and you love the spotlight, well, turn the spotlight from yourself onto others. Elevate, exalt, encourage, promote others. And I try and do this because these are areas in my life that I've had to work out most definitely. And this is one where, you know, you can like the spotlight, you like the accolades. And if we're honest, we all like encouragement. But I now try and encourage others. I've done it for many, many years. I try and lift others. I try and elevate others, others in our team. I'm forever trying to give praise to others, giving them the credit. I want to say that all of our campus pastors are doing an amazing job. I say that not because of this. They are. But it helps to elevate them, to bring the praise to them. Put the spotlight on others. Number five, prefer others above yourselves. That basically means put others first. So here's a challenge. When you're in a queue and you can see somebody's trying to push in and you're just at the side of who's going to go, just say, would you like to go in front of me? How about in the car? When you can see somebody wanting to pull out, why don't you just wave them through? Even if it means then you're stuck at the red light and they've gone through and you haven't, isn't that annoying? That shows there's an issue. Put others first. Number six, remember your life pre-Christ. Don't forget where you come from. When I'm tempted to go somewhere, I remember where I've come from. And I don't think that I've arrived or come anywhere. But, you know, listen, some people can see you there and they see themselves there. And I always say to people, listen, I'm here. I'm Christian. I wouldn't want you knowing some of the things in my life, some of the thoughts that I've had, some of the things that I've thought I've wanted to do, the mistreating of people. I'm ashamed of some of those things. I was just born into a normal life. I remember where I've come from. Even with all that God has blessed us with, both personally and collectively, I remember it's all from Him. And lastly, to deepen this humility, this is a big one, deflect and reflect all praise to Jesus. Praise Him always. Rejoice in the Lord always. I love what one person says, whatever you don't turn into praise turns into pride. I know we all like the thought of a pat on the back at times, but if you're forever living for that, that's a problem. Deflect praise and glory to Jesus. Turn it into praise so it doesn't turn into pride. I believe if we'll do the how-tos, if we'll understand what it means to live a humble life and take the example of Jesus, we will find great joy, great joy. There is joy. There is joy, unspeakable, unbounding joy in living a life of humility. Let's pray. The first starting point for every one of us is to confess our sins, our need of God. How we have messed up, how we have sinned, how we've done it our way. And we come to a holy God who is loving and kind and gracious. And we bow our knees and we confess our sins and we receive His forgiveness. Can I encourage you to do that in this moment? If that's you, just pray this prayer with me. Say, dear Jesus, I am so sorry for the things that I have done. I recognize that you are the Lord of the earth. You came to earth, hung upon a cross for my sins. Cleanse me now. Forgive me. Give me a brand new start. Friend, if you prayed that prayer, this is the first step of pursuing God and walking into a life of humility, not just humility, but peace and joy. Can encourage you to click on the screen, Can I encourage you to just allow Jesus in this moment to just touch you? Don't rush on, just linger for a moment, because he may be doing a deep work in your life. His desires that none should perish, that everybody would come to this point of salvation. Come on, lean in this moment, click on the screen, give your life to Jesus. Just linger in this moment of prayer, please, everybody, because it may be you're saying today, Christian, oh, I need to give careful attention to this area of my heart, joy and humility. Maybe something of what I've said challenged you. It's challenged me. Why don't us in this moment just bring our hearts before God? God, we do not want to leave anything unattended. Search us, test us, know us. If there's any way that's not pleasing to you, we submit it to you now. May our lives be marked by humility. May people know the love that we have for you and for others. May we look to the interests of others, not just ourselves. And may this virtue and value run through every area of our lives, not just in the church, but in our homes, in our workplaces, in our dealings with others. And we ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. Let us live with this humility. May it mark our lives, and may we know the joy of it. Guys, I just love the fact that we're together, even though it's been very difficult. Can I encourage you to keep being a presence carrier? Keep sharing the love of Jesus to your friends. There's only one hope. His name's Jesus. There's only one answer. His name's Jesus. And we can carry that message to our very, very broken world. Thank you for those who are helping us by praying. Thank you for those who are helping us in serving. Can I encourage you, please, to come back to one of our locations if you feel comfortable now. We need the serving teams back. We're cranking it up. We really believe in this next season we're going to reach more people. We're going to serve more people than we've ever done in the history of the church. In Jesus' name. As always, guys, I love you. I'm praying for you. And I believe in you. God bless you.
What a great message from our lead pastor, Kristian. We're so blessed at Arena, aren't we? Week after week, we get amazing messages that challenges and impacts us. We're coming to the part in our service now, which is our giving part. And I want to encourage you with this verse in Proverbs. The world of the generous gets larger and larger. You know, Arena, we know that to be true, and we believe it to be true. So as we do our next song in worship, let's give of our offerings.
These bones will sing, great are you, Lord. All the earth will shout your praise, our hearts will cry, these bones will sing, great are you. Will shout your praise, our hearts will cry, these bones will sing, great are you, Lord. All the earth will shout your praise, our hearts will cry, these bones will sing, great. Your breath. So we pour out our praise to you only. It's your breath in our lungs. So we pour out our praise. Pour out our praise. It's your breath in our lungs. So we pour out our praise to you only. All the earth will shout your praise. Our hearts will cry. These bones will sing. Great are you, Lord. All the earth will shout your praise. Our hearts will cry. These bones will sing. Great are you, Lord.